Hi, Deanna.
Hi, Millie.
What's up, guys? So this is my amazing dad, Gary. And as you can see, we're not in Minnesota, thankfully. We are in Punta de Mita, Mexico right now, celebrating my dad's remission from cancer. Big reason to celebrate. So to kind of give a little bit of a backstory, last year, my dad got diagnosed with cancer, stage 4 esophageal cancer. And it was really hard for the family, obviously. And around that time, I found a channel called Eamon and Beck. And Beck got diagnosed with breast cancer, and I was watching her videos while dealing with my dad's cancer diagnosis, and I just felt like it really helped me kind of process through everything. And that's my hope with this video today, just to kind of give some hope to those of you that are going through something similar, and just to share his story. When did you get the official diagnosis?
It was actually around this time, March of last year, 2022. Yep.
Do you remember when you went to the doctors and you got the news that you had cancer, like what that felt like?
Having experienced the same situation that you're experiencing with my own dad, because I'm very close with my dad. He's like
very close.
My best friend is what I call him all the time. I kind of knew what to expect. I went into the endoscopy pretty much knowing that I probably had a tumor in there, just based on the difficulties that I was having swallowing and things.
Yeah.
So I was not at peace with it, but it didn't freak me out as much.
You're kind of expecting it.
Yes.
I think on my end, I was kind of not expecting it to happen. Well, I'm already gonna start crying. I knew this was gonna happen, Dad.
It's okay.
I remember my dad called me. I got a call from him, and I missed the call because Daniel, my husband, had just gotten home from work, so I didn't answer my dad's call. And then he texted me, and he was like, call me when you can. And in that moment, I was like, something's wrong. And I'm the type of person that always goes to like worst case scenario.
Yes.
As he knows.
Big time.
So I call him back, and he's like, Mel, I got to tell you something. I went to the doctor. I've been having trouble swallowing. And as soon as he said that, I knew that it was something to do with cancer because of what you went through with your dad. And I remember like trying so hard to stay strong on the phone. I was like crying a little bit on the phone with him. And he was like, so my dad to worry about me instead of himself. He's like, I'm going to be okay, mija. Like, don't worry. Like trying to calm me down. And so I was like trying to stay strong. And as soon as I hung up the phone with him, I just broke down.
I didn't know that.
Bawling my eyes out. My husband is just like holding on to me because I am just like all the worst case scenarios going through my head again of like wanting my dad to be there when I have kids and like wanting to him to like be able to experience being a grandpa and like just thinking about like all the fears of like what if the worst happens. And that was so scary. And then I called my brother Ryan, who is also my best friend, and I was like, Rye. And he sounded so calm. He was like, Mel, he's going to be fine. It's not a big deal. So that made me feel a little bit better. But
well, like I said, having my dad go through the same exact type of experience, I already knew what to expect. And I should add that my dad, 6 years later, is alive and well and very vibrant 79-year-old man. So I had that hope to hang on to. And one of the most pivotal moments for me in when I got my dad's call about his cancer diagnosis, I went into the same exact type of mindset. Worst case scenario, my dad's gonna die, he's old, you know, all these things. And I reached out to some of my friends, let them know about my dad's cancer diagnosis. And the most impactful comment that I got from one of my friends was, what an amazing opportunity you have to draw even closer to your dad through this illness. And that was like a switch in my head, because I had spent 2 or 3 days, you know, just really lamenting the fact that I was gonna have to deal with this and worry about my dad passing away. And when that message came through, it was like, that's exactly it.
Yeah.
I'm gonna focus on that. I'm gonna focus on being there for my dad. I'm gonna focus on being closer to him. And so when my cancer diagnosis came around, I was a lot more able to deal with it.
Yeah. I think that's part of what was hard about your diagnosis too. My dad and I have had a very strong relationship for most of my life, but we've also had to work really hard to get it to that point. Like, we've had some struggles in our relationship, and I feel like we've worked so hard to like build a strong father-daughter relationship, and it was just kind of like, gosh, he's also one of my best friends. Like, we travel together, like my dad and I, like whenever we're hanging out.
It feels good to hear my daughter say that.
Like, we're very, very close, and I feel very fortunate to have that relationship. So it's just like, gosh, I finally have this like really close relationship with my dad, and the possibility of that getting taken away was really scary also. Anyways.
Yeah, so if there's a message that we're trying to get across is it's human nature to have that negative reaction and the fear the worst kind of reaction, but my suggestion would be to move past that, experience that, and then get into that mindset of how can I draw closer to the person who's going to be there for me, and try to have that type of positive outlook on it.
Mm-hmm. For sure. That was something that Daniel did a really good job of, because when he first called me to tell me about his cancer, like, we didn't really know the stage of it. We didn't know how serious it was. All we knew was his diagnosis of esophageal cancer. And so Daniel was just like, we don't know anything yet. Like, don't freak out until you know. But then you did call me a few weeks later and said that it was stage four. I think that was the other hard part, is I'm in school right now and learning about a lot of these like health things. And like, we'd be in class and they'd be talking about cancer, and like, oh, that was, of course, like, you hear stage four cancer, you think that's a death sentence.
Yeah.
Like, at least that's, like, in movies, anytime they're like stage four, you're like, that's, he's gone.
Yeah.
So that was, and then also, like, I live in Minnesota and my dad lives in California, so that was really hard not being able to be there and support you. And, but I was calling him like every day. You're not eating any sugar, are you, Dad? Oh, you better not be drinking alcohol.
Yes. Felt like I had my mom calling me all the time.
What would you say are some things that helped you the most, like, throughout the process?
First and foremost, my faith in God.
Yeah.
I prayed a lot, and it didn't feel like it sometimes. He was with me, but I kept my faith, prayed a lot, and he's brought me through it.
Yeah.
Didn't think I was going to cry.
You always cry.
That was a good question. The other part of it for me is I'm not one who readily accepts help from people. Mm-hmm. So having to let go of that, you know, desire to be strong and not rely on people was difficult for me, but realizing that when I did, that the people that I needed to be there for me were there. Mm-hmm. My father was there to take me to my appointments. My sons were there to pick me up and take me to appointments and bring me food. And then my daughter, you know, put in a request at school to be able to go to school remotely, then flew from Minnesota to the house and stayed with me for 10 days and fed me and took care of me while I laid there and did absolutely nothing. And it was so comforting to know that I had that amazing family to surround me and just show me how much I'm loved and cared for. And that's a really, really good feeling.
You know, I'm in my doctorate program, and that was the first thought that I had when my dad called me. It was like, how do I get out there? Like, am I going to be able to get out there? My school is so amazing. I remember meeting with my advisor, and I just like broke down in her office, and I was like telling her about my dad's diagnosis, and just like asking her, like, what are my options? Like, am I going to need to defer for a year? Like, what can I do? And she was like, whatever you need, we will make happen. And I'm so, so, so grateful. To kind of echo what my dad said about leaning into God, like, so grateful for my small group that I have for my church too, because I know every single day there are seven women praying for you. I texted everyone that I knew, please pray for my dad, please pray for my dad. And I really think that's a big reason why you're still here today, is because the power of God.
Absolutely. Sure. I had so many people, friends, who wanted to come and do my yard, wanted to bring me food, wanted to do anything that, you know, take me to my appointments. Yeah. And all I would tell them is I have an amazing family that's taking care of those things for me. I just need you guys to pray.
Yeah.
Just pray for me. And knowing that I had a whole army of people out there praying for me, really gave me a lot of comfort. And again, my faith in God, I'm not going to say it didn't waver, because there were times where I was really struggling and in a lot of pain, but I maintained my faith, and mm-hmm. it just really got me through a lot. So
you also had some amazing nurses, though, that ended up being like family to you through it all. So I'm super grateful for.
Yeah, I have a newfound respect for the nurses. I mean, they put up with a lot. I mean, being in a hospital ward for 2 weeks and seeing and hearing the other patients around and knowing what the nurses are dealing with and understaffed and things like that, and for them to still be very caring and supportive is a big testament to their level of character and love that they have in their hearts for people. I was very, very fortunate that God put those nurses in my place. One of them even lost her father to esophageal cancer. Ugh. 2 years prior, so she understood what I was going through, and we ended up crying and hugging together towards the end when I left. Yeah, it was there's some amazing professionals out there as well.
What would you say was your hardest part about cancer, or the most challenging?
Definitely the surgery.
Yeah.
I can remember going in and having the meetings with my chemotherapy oncologist and my radiation oncologist, and you know, the radiation oncologist telling me, hey, this is gonna be tough. You know, I had to go to radiation every day for 6 weeks and chemo once a week for 6 weeks. And the radiation oncologist was telling me, you're probably not gonna be able to get through all these treatments without really getting sick. And I remember thinking in my mind, watch me. And I really did. I did really well until the last few weeks and I got sick, but the surgery was really tough.
Yeah.
They had to cut out half of my esophagus and then pull my stomach up into my chest area to reconnect to what was left of my esophagus. And that left me with some difficulty eating solid foods for a while, and then obviously took up some of my stomach capacity. I think now the hard part is realizing that I'm much weaker and my body looks much different than it did when I first started. I was 230 pounds, a little bit on the heavy side, not too bad, but I worked out, I was muscular, and now I'm 165 pounds and skinnier, and definitely not anywhere near as strong as I was. And mm-hmm. that's taken some time to get used to.
Yeah, I think when my dad first got diagnosed, he was very good about your mindset. Like every time I call you, like, it's all right, God is good. Like, I'm gonna beat this thing, like very positive and so strong throughout the entire process. And I think after the surgery, that was like hard to see him go through like the roller coaster of emotions, and especially after you were hospitalized. So after his surgery, he ended up getting a really bad lung infection and was hospitalized for almost 2 weeks, was it?
Just a little over 2 weeks, right before Christmas.
And he lost so much weight. My entire life was known as like being the big guy. Little did they know, he's such a teddy bear, like cries very easily, has such a big heart. Yeah, so needless to say, last year was definitely a hard year for our family with my dad's cancer, but so grateful to be here in Mexico for a good reason, celebrating
buddy.
My dad's remission, and my brothers are getting in today, and we're just gonna enjoy time, and just full of gratitude.
That's what it's all about, having the family around and celebrating the victory over cancer. It's important to do.
Woo! Anyways, thank you guys so much for watching. We hope you enjoyed this little bit of different video this week. Hope you have a great rest of your day. I'll see you next time.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks,
appreciate
Dad.
It.
Come here, Diana.
Love you.
Ha ha ha.